Hey folks, good afternoon. Wow, so good to be here. Got some folks coming in. Good to see the numbers rising. Yeah, come on, join us.
Everybody.
Hey, yeah. You doing all right, Nolan?
I'm doing great, great. I've got my assistant, Randy, logged in here. I think she's under my account, but feel free to comment and she'll be checking in with y'all as well.
Oh, that's fantastic. For those who don't know me, my name is Kim Davis. I'm the senior advisor with the Walton Family Foundation, and I lead our work in the Arkansas-Mississippi Delta region. Some of you know this, but the foundation has been committed to doing work in the Delta since its inception, and we love supporting the people and building lasting impact in the Delta. But as you all know, like so many rural places, the Delta holds a tremendous amount of incredible potential. And throughout my time at the foundation, I've had the opportunity to meet some amazing folks with incredible potential and are doing amazing things in the Delta, like our guest here today, Mr. Nolan Dean. For those of you who don't know, Nolan is an award-winning filmmaker based in the Arkansas Delta. He centered his practice on producing really compelling narratives about the work in the Delta, and he's done some amazing work. Nolan and I have known each other for some time now, and I've been immensely impressed with everything that he's been able to do. He got to the Delta through a relationship he had with his wife, and according to Nolan, and you could tell the story, Nolan, once you got there, you stuck. But you are one of these folks that we call an amazing emerging leader in the Delta. And sometimes those folks are overlooked. And so we at the Walton Family Foundation really want to highlight the incredible leadership that happens throughout the Arkansas and Mississippi Delta. And we are so proud, Nolan, to kind of give you some time and space to have an opportunity with me today to have these conversations. Over the years, we've talked a lot about these things. And so it's great to be able to do it in the company of all of our friends here on social. So with that, Nolan, I'd like for you to just to spend a little bit more time. Do yourself far more justice than I have in regards to the intro and the amazing work that you
did. Yeah, no problem. I mean, so I think the big thing that you mentioned there is that it was a relationship that brought me here. So Jackie Dean, she was a Teach for America teacher who stuck around for her fourth year, and I was living in Little Rock. We both come from Texas. We're both graduates of University of Texas at Austin. And I was in Little Rock, and I was wondering, what is this lady doing, and what's this place that she's in? I'm really interested in that. We were kind of had a lot of mutual friends. And so I did a character interview of her, and everyone said I just wanted to date her, but I didn't know that yet. I quickly fell in love with Jackie, and not just her, but her place and her life and her community. I wanted the whole package. And so that was about 9 years ago. And my soul has always very, from that first trip, connected with this place because, and with her, they're a great picture of one another. It's authentic, rich in community, rich in a soulful kind of simplicity. And, you know, I deal in stories. That's my trade. And this place is rich in story. And it's easy to live an important and meaningful story with my own life here in the Delta.
Yeah.
It can be difficult in other places.
Nolan, double click on that. Dive a little bit deeper into that, because it's something that I've recognized in doing my work there is around the tremendous number of stories. And dare I say characters, right? Personalities that you find in a place like the Delta. It must be just such a rich, fertile ground for you in your space.
Oh, I feel like a gold miner in 1849 California who landed on this place and realized no one else knows what's here. Like I'm not the only person doing this here, but I'm one of the only people doing this here comparatively from the places that I come from. And there's more stories than what you could shake a stick at. And the fiction that I'm able to write here as a screenwriter feels truer than life. And the true stories I'm able to capture here is almost stranger than fiction is what I like to say. It's like this incredible, I mean, mosaic of powerful historical stories to tell of crazy. I'm a big fan of the NPR show, This American Life. like this American lifestyle storytelling, music, every project that happens here that I get to capture from a commercial standpoint also is very rich and meaningful. No day looks the same for me, and I really appreciate that.
Yeah. You know, Nolan, in my time in the Delta, I have run across, as I mentioned in the beginning, just some incredible individuals like yourself in all different types of spaces that, in all honesty, I remember sort of walking away going, to your point, why don't more people know about the incredible leaders and the incredible folks in industry that take place in the Delta? And why, you know, how can we help to ensure that Nolan Deans and others, right, folks are aware of those folks? Tell me, why do you think this sort of talent is not as discovered in the same way that it might be in other places that you mentioned?
Yeah, so this is something I think about a lot. Geographic isolation comes in as a big point. We're also far off the beaten path of interstates. So human migration just hasn't flown through here as much. You've got, in an amazing way, you've got some really old, deep-rooted families that have been here for 4, 5, 6 generations. But on the other hand, that doesn't always lead to a lot of people from outside of here having strong connections and relationships with the Delta. Most people that you try to talk to, if they haven't had any interactions with it, they think you're kind of talking about Mars. They have a very hard time conceptualizing the Delta outside of the movies that they've seen, right? Or the blues music. Usually it's set in the 30s or 40s or 60s. And most people don't have a conception of what the modern Delta looks like, or what the modern Delta's culture is.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's interesting. And to that modernization piece, right, I've been over the last couple years like really trying to think about that. And the Walton Family Foundation's really been trying to think about that, particularly around narrative, right? This is your space. Narrative is your space. So two questions. One, how do we help folks through a narrative format understand and modernize their take of the Delta? And then two, specifically, what can we do? What can foundations do to help around this narrative storytelling piece? I'd love to get your insight.
Yeah, so that's a great question. I mean, one of the things that I feel like my role is here is to amplify good people and good projects and good stories. And I do that through whether I'm a documentarian and I'm trying to tell a story in which I'm trying to re-knit the community back together, or I'm telling a story for an organization like Thrive or Griot Arts, you know, who y'all support, and we're trying to amplify their work. And or just anything that's positive. I'm trying to give a megaphone that's louder than kind of some of the negative conversations that happen around town when people are kind of disgruntled about this or that. As a screenwriter, I feel like one of my big tasks is to tell stories about the modern Delta that capture its mystique and its allure. This is a very captivating place. It's a very beautiful place. And I don't see that beauty communicated. Usually the Delta has been portrayed through film as a very harsh place, right? As a kind of a brutality. And certainly it has a very, very challenging history, but there's more to it than that. There's always more than one side of a story.
Yeah.
What y'all can do, I mean, first off, I want to say I'm very honored for y'all elevating my story with that article that Sheldon wrote with Rory Doyle's photography. I was just blown away by the way that y'all have captured me and captured my heart and really communicated my life's work here.
Shout out to Sheldon. Y'all should definitely go check that out. I know it's posted on the Walton Family Foundation website, the blog there that highlights Nolan's work. I would invite everybody to go check that out. It's an amazing piece that gives some really great insight into Nolan and the amazing work. Sorry to cut you off, but
that's good. I'm rambling anyway.
No. That's really, really good. And into that narrative, well, I'm going to back up because you were getting into what we can do more of. So I don't want to sidetrack you from talking about how foundations can support individuals like yourself and narratives in the narrative space.
Yeah, I mean, whenever we had this conversation privately before, I think my response was hire me. I'm a storyteller here.
Amen.
And it's something that we have the capability of doing, of telling the stories of your grantees and really making them shine and making them attractive and hopefully sharing this message to other foundations around the country that says something's cool is happening there. We should get in on that.
See, this is why I like you. This is why you're my guy. Because you're absolutely right.
I'll tell you another thing too. I mean, obviously y'all are a foundation. Y'all give resources that support leaders, that support social change through nonprofit and social entrepreneurship. So obviously foundations giving, identifying good leaders, helping them grow and giving to it creates those stories that can be told as well. And y'all know that. Y'all are in the business of creating good stories in the here and now. But the Delta is like, it is the most misunderstood place in the country. I mean, you have so many people that are working so hard to make this place wonderful. And we're living amazing lives. We're getting to live out our dream and helping others and still like having a good quality of life. The quality of life here, if you're middle class, is higher and more significant and meaningful than any urban area in the country. I'll put us up against anybody.
Yeah.
Anybody.
Yeah. I will take that. Okay, here is my shot. I've been pitching this idea now.
Yeah.
It seems like
a serious story.
Yeah, yeah. When I talk about the Delta, I tell folks for me, and I spend a tremendous amount of time there. I talk about it for me in the same vein of the Land of Oz, mm-hmm. right? And I tell folks instead of yellow brick roads, they're meandering dirt roads. Mm-hmm. Instead of, you know, poppy mm-hmm. fields in The Wizard of Oz,
absolutely.
There's soybean fields, right?
Absolutely.
The Emerald City is kudzu, right? That mm-hmm. takes shape for whatever it covers, right? Mm-hmm. So it's just this mystical, magical place. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I always say, and you want to talk about characters, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Lions and tigers and bears have nothing mm-hmm. on the type of purposeful characteristics and individuals you find in the Delta. Am I on the right track?
Oh, you're absolutely. I'm a friend of Bubba O'Keefe, the tourism
yep.
director of Clarkston.
Yep.
One of his favorite sayings is that we've got more characters than Sesame Street.
Yeah.
And that's absolutely true of Clarksdale. He's specifically talking about the music scene, but I find that to be true of the entire Delta all the way around. I was out filming on a buddy's farm. My friend's Mark Nolan has a regenerative cotton farm in the Mississippi Delta. First person that I know of that's pioneering regenerative farming in this area for cotton. And I was on a cotton picker with his guy, Otis, who's been working on the farm for 30 years. And Otis was this guy who just had, I mean, you could feel the land on every single inch of him, you know, on every line in his face. Super, super sharp guy, really kind. But he's just a guy that stuck out that is just like, man, there is so much humanity here in every individual.
Yeah. No, I tell people all the time, it is such a soulful place, as you sort of mentioned, right? You can really feel, you know, the past and the present kind of coming together and moving forward. It is no surprise that it's the place that some of the greatest authors of our time have written some of the greatest masterpieces of our time. Because, mm-hmm. you know, if you spend a little time there, which I encourage everyone who, if you have not spent time in the Arkansas-Mississippi Delta, I'm encouraging you to do so. Don't hesitate. reach out to Nolan, reach out to me. We'd be more than happy to spend some time with you there. But it really is kind of this soulful, comforting place. You know, I tell the story, I was with a colleague driving around and we were going to hit up a barbecue spot. And, mm-hmm. and it was one of these places where, you know they run out really early because the food is just so amazing. And so he gave a call in early and, you know, the person on the other end said, well, honey, I need a name for the order. And he said, my name is Joe. And she said, uh-uh, honey, pick another name. We already got a Joe. Right? So that is like, to me, that's how it feels. Like, you know, who are you kind of person? And we already got one of those. We need you to be authentically who you are. We don't need a lot of Joes. We got some Joes, right? And so it just feels very natural, very comforting, a kind of push to help you think about yourself in a different sort of way. I really appreciate you and talking about that. Yes. The last thing I'll say, and this, and I know we're getting some questions here that I want us to answer because they're coming through the chat. But Nolan, you spent some time, like one thing that you've done is spend time with the youth in the Delta. Sure. I mean, you want to talk about emerging leaders, which I consider you, once again, one of those emerging leaders, a leader of the Delta. But you've also spent some time with some individuals that are younger, some high school age folks, and you've seen some amazing work and work ethic come from those folks. Can you talk about that next generation leadership and what you're finding in this space?
Yeah. You know, I think that one of the most wonderful aspects of Thrive and Helena is the way that they instill community pride in youth by engaging them in projects that better their community, whether it's a mural, designing a trail. And it's amazing whenever you begin to give young people work to do, dignifying work to do that improves their community, how much ownership they begin to take over it. You know, it is, I don't know, it's just amazing. What you really want to see is for them to be able to come up and thrive and pursue any type of career that they would want to, not just a career limited in like the very small kind of traditional opportunities here, which typical of small towns. You want to be able to see these very creative youth pursue creative careers and stick here and not have to move away in order to pursue their dreams, whatever they happen to be.
Yeah, shout out to Thrive. And for my funders that are on the call, if you're looking for an organization that does an amazing job with career pathways and engaging youth around career pathways, as you sort of mentioned, Nolan, Thrive is a great place to start. And you should all look up Thrive and kind of the amazing work they're doing. Or you mentioned earlier Griot Arts, right, and what's happening there. An amazing little coffee shop that they have there.
It's a tremendous, there's a tremendous amount of talent. There's a tremendous amount of talent.
Yeah, you're right.
You know, I've been trying to crack the nut on how to get young people involved in the film industry and give them job training skills to enter film production because the work ethic and the amount of talent, I think, would be a really nice fit for that. And there's so much storytelling potential if an industry could be built here locally. There's the sky's the limit. The programming just needs to be created for whatever. And young people here are so usually hungry for good opportunities.
I'm going to get to the questions that are in the chat, I want you to invite, because I know we had this conversation. I want you to now take the time to kind of invite and talk about, invite your filmmaking friends and talk about from a set design standpoint, when you sort of go through some of these small towns that have been there forever, tell them what they're getting, Nolan, if they were to come and think about doing something in the Arkansas-Mississippi.
Yeah. Well, I want them to come work with me, not steal all my sets, number one. Imagine having a production. So what I'm working on right now, for example, is a film called Blues Town. It's market value if you read the script, you'd say $9 million. That's what they spent to make it. Maybe two at the lowest. And we're going to do it for $600,000.
Wow.
The reason why we're able to do that is because our art department is so low. I mean, that's one of the reasons. There's a couple of reasons. But our art department's so low because we don't have to build sets. We don't have to spend too much money decorating sets. And we don't have to pay expensive location permits. There yeah. is so much like just out these windows right here. If you go down Cherry Street, everyone's first thought is this is a movie set.
Yeah.
The Last of Us that's shooting in Georgia, the HBO series, they would probably be saving a lot of money if they were shooting it here because they wouldn't have to do anything to any of these buildings. They're all here.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Right. That's great.
Unfortunately. But when Walk the Line was shooting here, the director and the cinematographer were on Cherry Street with, you know, Joaquin Phoenix and Reese Witherspoon. And the cinematographer looks over to the director. This is overheard by our former mayor, Kevin Smith. And it just made him so proud in that moment. He looked over to him and says, man, don't you wish you could just roll up this entire town and take it to the back lot with us?
Wow.
Like it's unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's great. Hey, we got a couple questions that are in the chat. And there's one for you, I see here, one for me, and then one for both. I'm going to ask you the one for you, and then I'll get to the one for me. It says, how do you envision harnessing the power of storytelling as a filmmaker committed to promoting cross-cultural empathy and human welfare in the Delta to reshape narratives and inspire positive change? Mm-hmm. Okay, whoever made up that question, boy, you got a lot going on. So
yeah.
That's really.
I can take it, but I've got to divide it into two segments, if that's okay.
Yeah.
So let's look at reshape narratives and inspire positive change, promote cross-cultural empathy. I see these two audiences as within the Delta, and how do we reshape narratives within these communities so that we can start knitting together fractured communities? Whether it's racial segregation or economic segregation or what, how can we re-knit those together? But then also, how can we reshape the narrative that the outside world has about the Delta, which is often kind of negative, that this is this backward place. They don't move forward. Your grant dollars there won't do any good. Those people can't be helped. How do we reshape those narratives? From within the honestly, with both, it's the power of storytelling. Whenever you're making a movie, you're telling a story, you're writing a novel, what you're doing is you're diving under people's conscious level of thought, and you're diving into their subconscious. And it's called emotional manipulation, to be honest, but you're emotionally guiding them through this journey that begins to like turn levers and pull switches and reconnect wires that were broken inside of people's hearts. Whenever we do that, we come away from powerful stories changed. We have more empathy naturally for the subjects that we saw. Now, I might not convince you of this one thing. You might politically still vote the same way, right? We may not agree about everything, but you will have been shaped, changed, and challenged in some way, even just a little nudge. And so telling stories within the region has really helped, I think, connect people. The story of the Elaine massacre, for example,
yeah.
very controversial story. Yeah. So, but everybody has their take because it's so personal, it's so close. But if I can highlight stories that are true and do it in such a way that's beautiful and not self-righteous, then I can begin to reshape people's thoughts or even challenge them in a positive way and not in a judgmental way.
Yeah. No, thanks for that. Thanks for that. Yeah. That's a great answer. The question for me that I see here was, mm-hmm. how do you identify people to collaborate with, particularly those on the ground? What methods or criteria do you employ to catch the attention of grassroots initiatives and individuals? Mm-hmm. I absolutely love this question, and I'll tell you why. I am past the point in which I should be giving credit, but to what I'm about to say to this individual, mm-hmm. Sanford Johnson, mm-hmm. but I'm going to go ahead and do it. I always like to say the first time I give credit to the person, the second time I say, like they always say, and then the third time I say, like I always say, right?
That's right.
I'm way beyond, I've quoted this so much, I'm way beyond the third time. But Sanford talks of wearing a jersey, not a cape, right? And I fully identify with that. This idea that when I am working with, and when the Walton Family Foundation is working with a community, we're a part of the community. Now, what does that mean very tangibly? It means a couple of things. One, as you know, Nolan, I spent a tremendous amount of time there, but not only am I there, we got boots on the ground. And dare I say, we're one of the few national / international foundations with boots on the ground. Abe Hudson Jr., shout out to Abe. Abe lives in Clarksdale, Mississippi. He knows it very well. So we knew that that was important. And in all honesty, our stakeholders pushed us to say, if we're going to be working in community, we need to go ahead and be there with folks. So we wear jerseys. We don't wear capes. We don't come in with answers. We listen to people. We work with them. We problem solve. We help provide resources, all those things. The second thing I would say is whenever I move into a new community, one, I'm always looking at the local paper. So we need to keep local papers alive and local periodicals alive. And then I do what's called the gimme five technique. Whenever I meet with somebody, I say, you tell me five other people that you think I should meet with, right? And I'm not talking about the mayor, and no disrespect to the mayor and the city council people, but I want to know kind of the individuals who have really strong opinions about work and efforts that are happening. So those are the ways in which I like to navigate community and really get close to community. And then the third thing, I will give one more. As I sort of mentioned, during the summer, you're probably going to find me, I don't know why I choose the summer, but you're going to find me in the Delta there for an extended period of time. Mm-hmm. And it's not to stack my schedule with meetings. It really is to go to church where folks go to church, go to the softball game, go to the after-school play. Like, I want to be as much a part of the community as I can. And so there are a lot of folks that I consider, you know, not just grantees or not just residents, but really like family of mine when it comes to my Delta family that helped me understand how folks are living their day-to-day lives and what we might need to do as a foundation. So whoever put that question in there, I really thank you for that. Nolan, we're at the wrap-up part. Is there anything you want to say in sort of wrapping up our time together?
I want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
What do you love about the Delta, Kim? Because you love this place. And why should other people love the Delta and be doing the same work that you're doing?
I do. It's a couple things. It's home for me. My mother and father grew up in real rural communities in Louisiana. I spent my summers there. My father grew up in a place that's called New Roads, Louisiana. And I like to say there hasn't been a new road built in that place since the 1960s.
Yeah. Yep.
And so it brings me back to how I sort of grew up. It's the hug. It really is. It's the community hug that you get. Nobody's a stranger. As you sort of mentioned, folks are ridiculously talented and hardworking. Like, who doesn't want to be around that? And so that's kind of how I'd like to, that's how I like to spend my time. I brought my kids there. I've sort of shown them around. I was like, hey, hop in the car. Let me show you something really special, right?
So
any chance I get to sort of navigate and drive through that, I do my best to do so. So I really appreciate
it. Well, now we know why you come here in the summers. You just can't get the heat and humidity out of your blood.
I know. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. No. And look, let's talk about the food. You got to go there if you want some amazing food. So absolutely. I really appreciate that question.
Yeah.
And I'm inviting anyone who's here today to please don't hesitate to reach out to me. I'd be more than happy to show you around the Delta that I know and love. I know Nolan would be more than happy to show you around the Delta that he knows and loves. I want to invite you to learn more about the Delta by following us on social. Please don't hesitate to reach out. Follow the Walton Family Foundation on social as well. There's a lot of great information. There's amazing stories about individuals like Nolan that's there. We have some blogs that have been written by individuals in the Delta talking about their work. So please don't hesitate to join us. Nolan, I want to thank you so much for spending time. I will be seeing you in a few weeks, my friend.
Awesome.
Because it's about that time I get back there. As I mentioned to you earlier before we hopped on the call, I'm leaving today where I am, and I'm headed to another part of the Delta just to spend some time. So thank you for everything that you've done, my friend.
Can I plug our work that's coming up real quick?
Go for it.
And stay tuned for, I guess, late November, early December for a video that we're producing together on the Waltons' work in the Delta, which we'll try to showcase some newer stories from grantees. And I think it's going to be something extremely special and inspiring for other organizations that want to see the kind of work that they could do if they jumped in.
Well, I'm getting camera ready for that and any other projects you have going on.
I got my makeup ready for you, buddy.
All right. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, everybody. Thanks for joining.
All right. See ya.
Bye.